The chief executive's question time closes now.
The regular council meeting now commences. Questions. Question one, Mr. Holden Chow. President, Hong Kong's tourism industry has been on its last legs since the outbreak of the coronavirus 2019 epidemic. Members of the tourism industry look forward to an expeditious resumption of normal travel clearance between Hong Kong and the mainland so that flow of people to the two places will return to normal and the hardship of the tourism industry will be relieved. Regarding the support for the tourism industry, will the council, government inform this council, one, of the latest progress of the discussions between the government and the mainland authorities on the resumption of normal travel clearance, including whether adoption of the travel clearance arrangements between the mainland and Macau, which have been proved effective, has been considered so as to facilitate flow of people between two places and help Hong Kong's tourism industry recover. Two, given that the reverse disbursements of a new round of cash allowances to travel agents and practitioners and is one-off in nature, and the 2,000 temporary positions created will be cancelled following the progressive closure of the community vaccination centres, of the new measures put in place by the government to support travel agents and practitioners of the tourism industry to tide over the difficulties. Three, as mutant strains with higher transmissibility may cause the epidemic all over the world to persist for a long period, whether new measures in place to make good use of the currently excessive human resources and to provide more temporary positions, if so, of the details. Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development. President, in respect of the three parts of the question raised by Mr. Holden Chow, having consulted the Constitution and Mainland Affairs Bureau, the Civil Service Bureau, and the Labour and Welfare Bureau, my consolidated reply is as follows. One, the government understands the importance of early resumption of normal cross-boundary activities with the mainland and Macau. To achieve this goal early, the government will, on one hand, continue to stringently control the epidemic situation and speed up vaccination for members of the public, and on the other hand, to maintain close liaison with the mainland and Macau to actively explore the gradual resumption of normal cross-boundary activities amongst the three places in an orderly manner on the premise that the epidemic situation in three places is under control and there will not be additional public health risks posing on the three places. Along this direction, the return to Hong Kong scheme has just resumed in full today, while the chief executive has also announced yesterday the launch of the Come to Hong Kong scheme next week, which will allow non-Hong Kong residents from Guangdong province and Macau coming to Hong Kong without being subject to compulsory quarantine, with a view to further resuming cross-boundary activities between Hong Kong and the mainland too. The tourism industry is undoubtedly the hardest hit sector under the prolonged epidemic situation. The government has therefore provided support to the trade in various ways. Since 2020, the government has launched five rounds of schemes, not just one-off. Through the Anti-Epidemic Fund, AEF, to provide direct financial support to the tourism industry with a cumulative funding commitment amounting to around $2.6 billion, benefiting over 1,700 travel agents and around 21,000 practitioners, including travel agent staff, tour guides, tour escorts, and drivers of tour service coaches. In fact, as just announced in August, the latest round of support measures for the tourism industry is a targeted arrangement offered by the government having regard to the continuous difficulties faced by the tourism industry. Apart from providing direct financial support, the government has increased the financial commitment for the Travel Agents Incentive Scheme and Green Lifestyle Local Tour Incentive Scheme, GLIS, to around $150 million and $100 million, respectively. The GLIS has received active response from the trade, especially during the summer holiday in July and August. The scheme has received applications from over 410 travel agents involving subsidy amounts close to $28 million, which reflects that the scheme can bring assistance to the trade. In addition, the government just announced in the end of last month's extension of waivers and concessions of various government license fees and charges till the end of September next year, and that an additional $35 billion will be injected to the special 100% guarantee product under the SME financing guarantee scheme, while the application period will be extended to end of June 2022. The tourism industry can also benefit from these two measures. On the other hand, during the past 1.5 years, at times when the epidemic situation has improved, the government would actively try to create room for business for the tourism industry on the premise of containing the epidemic. Since the end April, the government has allowed the resumption of organizing local group tours of 30 persons or below with conditions. Since end June, the restriction restriction on the number of participants for group tours, with two-thirds of the participants having received the first dose of COVID-19 vaccine, has been relaxed to 100 persons. Besides, cruise to nowhere (CTN) itineraries for Hong Kong residents which do not involve ports outside Hong Kong resumed in end July. As at yesterday, 17 cores have departed, serving nearly 22,000 passengers. The second cruise ship operating CTN itineraries is also planned to resume service in October. That would should offer some help to the sector. The Hong Kong Tourism Board, Hong Kong TB, has also launched 5 rounds of the free tour and staycation deluxe programs in total, providing support of about $45 million to the tourism ministry. The latest programs include the launch of the free tours lucky draw in August, offering 20,000 reward quotas of free local tours to Hong Kong citizens who have received the first dose of COVID-19 vaccine, as well as the second round of staycation deluxe reward with a total also of 20,000 quotas. 3. The government has earmarked funding under the AEF in this and last year for creating time-limited jobs in 2 phases under the job creation scheme. The government has taken into account the underemployment situation of the tourism industry, and upon the proposal put forth by the trade, employed around 1,800 practitioners of the tourism industry under the second phase of the job creation scheme for providing operational and administrative support services at the community vaccination centres. On the other hand, the Employees Retraining Board, ERB, currently provides around 700 training courses to upgrade the employment-related skills of the unemployed. Starting from October 2019, ERB has also launched the LUP upgrading special scheme, offering a quota of 60,000 trainees in total. Trainees who have completed the reference training courses can receive training allowance up to $5,800 per month, among which the placement-tied courses would also offer follow-up placement services for the trainees. As at the end of June, about 5,800 employees with present or recent employment in the tourism industry enrolled in training courses under the LUP upgrading special scheme, accounting for around 7.6% of the total number of trainees enrolled during the period. The government will continue to support the tourism ministry on various fronts, maintain liaison with the trade, and put in place appropriate measures to assist them to tide over this challenging time. Thank you. Mr. Holden Chow. In the main reply, there's still no commitment that you would provide a targeted time-limited jobs again, like the 1,800 jobs last time to support the sector. I hope you have heard our voice. Now, my question is on the resumption of cross-boundary travel. Would the government actively take up discussion with the main authorities so you could design a tracing app with tracing function, so a health code app with tracing function, so Hong Kong people could use that app to go back to the mainland? Now, in the chief executive's question time, the chief executive mentioned that on the resumption of cross-boundary travel with the mainland, at the experts' meetings, there will be further discussion. And we've definitely heard your views, members, and we will pass on your views to the relevant authorities for follow-up. Thank you. Mr. Poon Siu Ping. The epidemic has been going for almost 2 years. It's really hit the tourism sector hard. Many tour guides have lost their jobs. Now, because the industry has had no business for so long, many have been forced to switch to other trades. Now, without resumption of travel, it's hard for the tourism industry to recover. Now, of course, you have been promoting local tours and green tours actively, and you have relaxed the size of the tour groups. But then for many tourist destinations in Hong Kong, they are old and outdated. There's no appeal. So have you reviewed local tourism facilities? Would you upgrade them and so you could promote the development of local tourism? Secretary, thank you for the question and the suggestion. Now, the Tourism Commission and the Tourism Board have been taking advantage of this period when there are few overseas visitors to make plans for the long-term development of various travel destinations in Hong Kong. As I mentioned before, 2 years ago, we announced the tourism blueprint. Well, yes, of course, the number of target visitors is not as expected, but we have spent no effort in enhancing the appeal of various travel destinations. First, we try to identify activities with local character. For example, there are green tours at Yinjimqi. We have the Arts Festival. We've worked together with the local residents on that event. And then we're also making use of installation art. And we also have launched design events in Shemshuipo and another district. And there will be a new round of such activities soon. On heritage conservation, we also take advantage of existing facilities so we could promote more local tourism with local flavor. And then we're making use of technology, say we use augmented reality and other creative technology to promote certain tourism destinations. And of course, we've received support from this council to reposition the ocean park. And the plan that you have just considered and agreed to is now being implemented. So we are working on all these fronts. The aim is to keep Hong Kong as one of the most attractive tourist destination. And so we take advantage of this period to make various preparations so we could enhance the appeal of local tourism and also the appeal of Hong Kong to overseas visitors. Thank you. Mr. Marvin Kwok. Thank you, President. I very much agree that the government should offer more time-limited jobs or training opportunities to the tourism sector. Under the 14th Five-Year National Plan, Hong Kong is given a new role. We should become a center of cultural exchange between the East and the West. I'm sure the tourism sector and the arts and culture sector should have more interaction and collaboration. I wonder if the ministry has ever considered this prospect and designed new training schemes. In particular, you have to consider the new roles to be played by Hong Kong. So for tour guides or tour escorts in Hong Kong, they could better understand our mission as cultural exchange center between the East and the West. So they could equip themselves properly. So in future, we could develop cultural tourism, and it could also guide overseas visitors to better understand about the cultural facilities in Hong Kong, such as the West Kowloon Cultural District and so on. Now, the secretary mentioned conservation projects as well. So you would you have any training to better equip our tourism practitioners so we could fulfill our role as a cultural exchange center between the East and the West? Secretary, thank you, Mr. Ma, for your suggestion. Well, that's exactly what we have just started doing. For the whole West Kowloon Cultural District, there are important facilities such as the M-Plus Museum and the Hong Kong Palace Museum. Very soon, they will be completed. Now, I've visited the management of the West Kowloon Cultural District. I also met with the Hong Kong Tourism Board. The two bodies are now in discussion to see how they could make the most of the new facilities and these cultural attractions. I understand the Tourism Board has approached the West Kowloon Cultural District. I understand the sector also takes very seriously these cultural facilities because they would be a huge attraction. So they will consider including these facilities as part of the local tour itineraries, and then later on they will further expand their scheme. Now, I mentioned we don't need large scale activities. For example, the Yinjimqi Arts Festival is not a large event, but it's attracted international attention. And also, of Hong Kong's role as a cultural exchange center. You know, arts, you know, the arts market is important in Hong Kong. We are now ranked second, so we've moved up one place. So on arts trading, that's of course a form of trading activity, but there are other activity events such as Art Basel, which was staged during the pandemic. And then there are large-scale auctions, and usually there will be exhibitions for, open to the public with these public auctions. So so these are all opportunities for us. Thank you, Mr. Yu Siwing. I would like to thank the administration for approving funding to support the tourism sector and travel agents. But then, you know, with tourism, you know, still not resuming, you could only address our immediate needs. Now, there's a scheme launched in September, you know, for every visitor coming to Hong Kong, they will be given a subsidy of $120. And then they leave, there's also a subsidy of $100. Each travel agent has 1,000 quota places. Now, you know, the boundaries crossings have been closed since last year, so many travel agents did not really apply for the subsidy. So could you talk to the Revenue Department Secretary? Because there's no resumption of no reopening of the borders yet, so how can you give other resources to the sector to tide them over to this tough time? Thank you. Now we have been in touch with the tourism sector, often with the help of Mr. Yu Siwing, and then we are launching various schemes, and if necessary, we'll make adjustments to the scheme so that we can make the most of the resources. Now, you mentioned the travel agent agents incentive scheme. Yes, if it's to involve overseas visitors, it would be difficult. That's why we still extend the scheme. And at the same time, we have another scheme for a local tour, that is green lifestyle local tour incentive scheme. We have increased the amount from to $100 million, and we see that the scheme has been well received. And then in the main reply, I mentioned other schemes as well. So we try to offer incentives to encourage spending. And for those who've been vaccinated, we encourage them to join the tours by the reward scheme. So that will still help travel agents to some extent. Of course, I fully appreciate that the tourism sector has been the hardest hit during the pandemic. So that's why in the anti-epidemic fund, we have you know, rolled out the largest number of rounds of schemes to help them. But we'll continue to listen to the views of the sector. Mr. Michael Look. Thank you, President. If we want to support the tourism sector, we have to bear in mind the spirit of there are always more solutions than challenges. Last week, the FTU co-organized a market, a local market. I went to the market. I think the sales performance was quite good. So would the government take the initiative to help the tourism sector to, you know, organize more such markets? So they won't need to, and then there could also be other experience tours that include elements of markets and so on at various attractions. And then you could also hire docents to give jobs to tour guides and escorts. Secretary, thank you. Yes, thank you for mentioning that pilot scheme. Now we see that with the epidemic easing, and there could be prudent relaxation of social distancing measures, we see that there are more activities being staged at, say, shopping malls and other places. So We will talk to the sector where the situation, where there are the conditions, we will be happy to take on board members' suggestion. Which part of your question has not been answered? Providing deploying docents at travel at tourist attractions, would you consider it? Now, at any tourist attractions, if they are appealing, the tourism sector could offer such a service. If they want to receive subsidy from one of our schemes, they just need to meet the requirements. For example, the Green Lifestyle Local Tour Incentive Scheme. The green element is rather common. So they could continue to apply for subsidy on a scheme if they want. Mr. Leung Chee Cheong. Thank you, President. About giving support to the tourism sector, the government has actually done a lot. So we ought to give credit for the secretary for the work done in the past period. On the development of tourism, I don't think we should just focus on the challenges presented because of the epidemic and then forget about promoting the future development of the tourism sector. You know, as another member pointed out, would you take advantage of this period to equip the sector better? That's something we need to consider. So my question is, when the tourism sector was booming, there were some 40 million visitors to Hong Kong each year. That's why we had a buoyant tourism industry at the time. Now, in future, probably, there may not be so many visitors coming to Hong Kong. So what sort of measures does the administration have? So you could, make sure that the tourism continue to contribute to our GDP. Secretary. Well, thank you, Mr. Leung, for your questions. They are actually the same thing. Although there are few visitors now, we must not stop in any way. So I fully agree with Mr. Leung. We need to plan for the future. That means on the macro level, we must make sure Hong Kong remains a popular travel destination and on the global map. So there are many of our brand name events that could not be held because of the epidemic, but we must not let people forget about these events. For example, the wine and dine events and other events that are very that are well known around the world. We have to still stage these events even online, so people will not forget about these brands. This is about maintaining our image. And then we're taking advantage of a technology, so we're hosting both offline and online events. These are short-term measures, but in the long run, we are seeing that visitors usually would visit the place online before they actually plan their itineraries. So we need to maintain the image of Hong Kong, making use of new media. On training and development, that's something we will continue to do. I mentioned that earlier. And this year, with the support of this council, we are not cutting our provisions to the Hong Kong Tourism Board, in particular in developing our brand and so on. So we will continue to work in this area and we will continue to listen to your views. Thank you.
Question two, Mr. Wilson Orr. Thank you, President. The number of public housing flats produced in the last financial year has hit a record low in 10 years. The average waiting time of general public housing applicants has been rising continuously, which was 5.8 years as at the end of March this year, and moving increasingly farther away from the target of providing the first public housing flat offered to general applicants at around 3 years on average. On expediting public housing production, will the government inform this council first, as the Hong Kong Housing Authority is using the modular integrated construction MIC method in constructing a 12-story building in the public housing development in Tung Chung Area 99 project as an MIC pilot project of the relevant progress. 2. What criteria on the basis of which and when HA will decide whether or not to adopt MIC method across the board in future? And 3. Of HA's other means apart from using MIC method and components produced with offsite prefabrication technology to speed up housing production, especially the means which can minimize the delays in works progress caused by factors such as inclement weather or manpower shortage? Thank you. Secretary for Transport and Housing. Thank you, President. My consolidated reply to the question raised by Mr. Wilson Orr is as follows. The government has been sparing no effort in identifying land for housing construction, and the total public housing production has been generally on the rise. The total public housing production in the five-year period from 2017 to 18 to 2021 to 22 is estimated to reach about 96,500 units, an increase of about 30,000 units as compared with the total public housing production for the previous five-year period, which is from 2012 to 13 to 2016 to 17. The Hong Kong Housing Authority will continue to adopt comprehensive planning and site-specific design to best respond to site conditions, expedite the development process, and optimize the development potential of each and every public housing site so as to increase the public housing production. HA has all along been open to new technologies and measures which can enhance productivity, construction speed, building quality, safety level, and environmental performance. The manufacturing process involved in modular integrated construction, MIC, bears a close resemblance to the off-site prefabrication generally adopted by HA. The merit of off-site prefabrication is that, as the components are manufactured in this factory, the production process is not affected by the weather and is subject to stringent quality control in the course of the mechanized production process. In recent years, HA has actively introduced volumetric precast components, including the smaller size volumetric precast bathroom and kitchen, in addition to precast concrete walls, semi-precast slabs, etc. At present, HA has adopted prefabrication for over 90% of the components in certain public housing projects and is able to build a typical floor with over 20 housing units in 6 days. A MIC module is built up from walls, slabs, and exterior walls pre-installed in the factory, together with all necessary finishes, fixtures, and fittings. It is then directly transported to the site for assembly. In identifying suitable projects for MIC, HA would consider selecting public housing sites with relatively simple site terrain, sufficient transportation network, and availability of storage area nearby. At the same time, HA also needs to consider challenges and mitigation proposals in terms of design, fabrication, transportation, installation, and long-term maintenance. After study, HA has selected one of the domestic blocks of the public housing development at Tong Chong Area 99 as the first pilot MIC project. The project is currently undergoing excavation and foundation works for the basement car park. Together with the construction works of the superstructure, the project is scheduled for completion in 2024. Nevertheless, not all HA's housing development sites can meet all the requirements of using MIC. For example, some of the sites are relatively narrow and small, with limited storage areas for components, or sites with hilly terrain. In order to map out the long-term solutions regarding site constraints, HA has selected a domestic block at Tak Tin Street and three domestic blocks at Anderson Road Quarry Site in June this year as MIC projects. HA will review the operation efficiency of MIC amidst the construction process, work out detailed analysis of the construction time, workflow and cost, and will work with the industry to explore means to optimize the application efficiency. HA will continue to proactively select more suitable public housing sites for adopting MIC. In addition, the government has been actively adopting MIC in transitional housing projects. Among the over 15,000 transitional housing units, about 90% of them are constructed using MIC. Moreover, in order to speed up the housing construction processes and enhance building quality, HA has been using new technologies proactively in recent years, including 1. Extending the application of building information modeling and other innovative technologies in planning, design, and construction stages, such as drones. 2. Utilizing mobile phones and mobile applications for site supervision and streamlining of on-site communication and workflow. 3. Using construction robotics to address labor shortage. 4. Making use of innovative technologies to improve site safety management. And 5. Applying and actively exploring modular integrated mechanical, electrical, and plumbing services. HA will continue through different methods, expedite the process of housing supply. Thank you. Mr. Wilson Orr. Thank you, President. It seems that the Secretary does not feel the urge of grassroots families. Well, there's to be an increase of 30,000 units in public housing in the coming years, but then there is a very long waiting period. I always say that using MIC in the 2017 policy address by the CE is a highlight, but now it's been 5 years. I have actually seen from data that there are 21 government accommodations and then around 8 schools and some other public buildings have already been using MIC method. Why do you say now that it's still in a trial period? On August 13th, I see from Oriental Daily an article saying that people have been waiting forever for public housing. These applicants and need to wait for many years before they can get public housing. Now you have set an increase of about 30,000 units for a 5-year period. Please don't wait, Secretary, because many people have been waiting forever and they still do not get allotted a unit. Secretary, thank you, President, and thank you for your question. I know that we will need to have around 96,500 units. You need that it takes about 3 to 4 years for design and building of public housing. Some projects are already in development, so we have used the traditional method for half the construction, and we cannot suddenly switch to the MIC method. The three areas that we have identified as pilot scheme shows our responsibility of the HA. First of all, the Tong Chong Area 99, because it's a flat terrain and with convenient transportation, there with enough storage, we believe it is suitable for a MIC housing project. Tak Tin Street is actually a narrow and small site with very congested traffic. There is also a PIC, and therefore it is quite challenging. We chose this deliberately to challenge ourselves. If we're able to overcome these restrictions and adopt MIC, then we'll be able to adopt MIC in more public housing projects. We also identified Anderson Road Quarry site because in the surrounding areas there are other public housing projects. As these are all subject to the same limitations, we believe that we'll be able to have a fair comparison between the different methods and to find which method is more suitable for Hong Kong in the long term. But please remember that there is no one method that can be used across the board. Adopting MIC is our goal. But then for sites that are not suitable for MIC, we will use other construction methods. I'd like to also report to members that in 2020 on the mainland, we have set up two stories of MIC, public housing units, because we want to identify the challenges and the resolutions. So through doing this at the factory, we'll be able to smoothly to resolve all the issues we face in Hong Kong. Mr. Chan Kwok-kwan, President, we see that actually the highest MIC building is a 16 to 17 story building in the Paxing Fire Services Department. This time, for the public housing project, we only talk about a 12-story building. According to your data and experience and technology, can the MIC method, or should I put it this way, is it suitable for around a 40-story public housing buildings? Do we already have this technology? If not, would you expedite the process in researching into this feasibility? Secretary, thank you for your question, Mr. Cheng. Well, yes, we can use MIC for a 40-story public housing building. We'll need to report to members that in Tak Tin Street, the building is to be 33 stories. We have considered public housing and the height restriction. We already tried to design it around the area and to maximize the number of flats. As long as there is enough storage for MIC and also convenient transportation, we'll be able to do it. Mr. Leung Ji Chang, thank you. This is quite a new technology in Hong Kong. In the construction period, we understand MIC is faster than the traditional building method. The secretary has mentioned that we are adopting pilot projects in different locations. We know that if you are going to prefabricate, then it will be done on the mainland, and then we will just have it transferred back to Hong Kong for assembly. Well, we already do not have enough construction workers in Hong Kong. If we are to widely adopt the MIC method, would all the offsite prefabrication be done on the mainland? And then workers in Hong Kong will not have enough jobs. Would you, while promoting MIC, also set aside certain sites for our workers in Hong Kong to also participate in offsite prefabrication? Secretary, thank you. We do see an aging population in Hong Kong. The Hong Kong government has been reviewing the adequacy of labor force in Hong Kong from time to time. We believe that for a period of time, construction workers for public housing and for public hospitals are currently enough. But then your concern is something we need to address as well. With a higher demand, we would then need to consider whether there is a need to set up a prefabrication factory in Hong Kong to provide more job opportunities. We're talking about increasing about 30,000 units in the next few years. There'll be about 210,000 units for public housing and private housing, and I'm sure that this will provide job opportunities for workers in Hong Kong. We will, however, pay close attention to the needs and demands. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok. President, the Secretary, in his reply, showed that the HA does want to promote the MIC method. We quite welcome public housing being built in the MIC method. However, there are restrictions to prefabrication. There are pros and at the same time cons in the use of land. Well, this is not limited to the housing authority. Would the administration relax some regulations, for example, the GFA for those who adopt the MIC method? Secretary, thank you, President, and thank you for your suggestion, Dr. Lo. We are already in close discussion with the sector on MIC. So all this is prefabricated and then assembled together. There are many work steps in that. We have been discussing with the Construction Council and the sector and trying to solve problems together. In future, when in MIC, we can look for further improvements. We will continue our communication with the sector and the private sector. Well, for MIC units that are done in steel and for those done in concrete, we have made a comparison. We are also in close contact with our mainland counterparts on the different techniques and technology. And we do draw reference from different methods and samples. I'm sure this wouldn't be a huge barrier. Mr. Paul Tse. President, I've heard the reply from the Secretary, and other than MIC, there are also other new technology such as building information modeling and other new innovative technologies. On the mainland, there are many machines that have multi-purposes. But due to our regulations, it's very hard for us to introduce in these machines. Are there any regulations in Hong Kong providing obstacles for us to introduce such new technology? When can we smoothly bring this new technology into Hong Kong? Secretary,
yeah.
when the construction sector applies new technology in terms of modular integrated construction, when we transport a MIC, there are limitations on the road. There is actually a limit on size because the roads in Hong Kong are very narrow. After discussing with the sector, we have relaxed the size of the MIC. So when we encounter such problems, we will brainstorm together to find solutions. At this moment, in MIC, the TPB and the DB and the entire construction sector will work together to resolve all issues.
Question number three, Mr. Paul J. President, there are public concerns about the government's practice over the years of spending huge sums of money on engaging consultants to publicize Hong Kong and take forward public works projects. For example, in 2001 and 2010, without extensive consultation, $30 million was spent on designing and promoting the Flying Dragon logo to publicize Brand Hong Kong, which was criticized as a black box operation. In 2015, nearly $70 million was spent on a consultancy on the EFLS for Kowloon East, which was not eventually adopted. Last June, $49 million was spent on engaging a consultancy to formulate strategy to publicize Hong Kong overseas. And last December, $550 million was spent on consultancy studies related to artificial islands in the central waters. A senior engineer has described this as a chaotic situation of consultants administering Hong Kong. In this connection, will government inform this council, one, whether it has any guidelines on engaging consultants, if not, whether it will do so, if it has, of the procedures and criteria, as well as the method for determining the level of consultancy fees, whether it has reviewed if the practice above was cost-effective. Two, whether it will, in conducting recruitment for civil service posts, accord priority to applicants with consultancy experience so that the research work can be entrusted to civil servants. Three, of the total expenditure incurred by the government in each of the past five financial years on engaging consultants to publicize Hong Kong and take forward public works, whether it has reviewed if such a practice is necessary and in line with the principle of fiscal prudence. Secretary for Financial Services and Treasury. President, having consulted the Development Bureau, the Home Affairs Bureau, and the Civil Service Bureau, my reply to the three parts of the question is as follows. One, if the expertise or qualified staff required for an assignment is not available in the government or within the time frame, and the recruitment of such staff is not appropriate, procuring department may appoint a consultant upon obtaining policy support. As the consultancy services appointed involve different portfolios, departments would determine whether to procure consultancy services, as well as the selection criteria, the assessment methodology, and weighting pursuant to the practical needs. Nevertheless, to procure consultancy services in support of government's program, departments should follow the government's established procurement policy and regulations and acquire value for money services through bidding procedures along the principles of fairness, competitiveness, openness, transparency, and integrity. The government would keep lists of consultancy firms of different categories for portfolios that frequently require consultancy for department's reference. Consultancy services employed by the government could be divided into three categories according to different fields, including engineering, architectural, and others. For consultancy agreement valued above the quotation limit, i.e. $3 billion but not exceeding $10 billion, the selection and appointment should be agreed and approved by the Departmental Selection Committee, or DCSC. As for consultancy agreements valued above $10 billion, depending on which sectors it belonged to, the appointment would need to be agreed and approved by the selection board, including the engineering Consultants Selection Board, the Architectural Consultant Selection Board, or the Central Consultant Selection Board. Moreover, the CEDD and the ASD have separately promulgated selection handbooks and technical circulars to set out the relevant regulations and guidelines for the consultancies, which have been uploaded to the web. Prior to inviting proposals, procuring department should formulate the assessment methodology and obtain approval from the relevant selection board. The method to assess proposals includes the weightings assigned to the technical and price proposals and the assessment criteria. Technical weighting should normally account for 60% to 70% of the overall score, while the price weighting 30 to 40%. The procuring department should set up an assessment panel to assess proposals using the assessment method. The procuring department would recommend the appointment of the consultancy firm with the highest combined score for approval by the relevant selection board. Works departments should follow the procedures prescribed by the EACSB or the AACSB when procuring engineering or architectural consultancy services. In general, all consultancy firms on the selection board's lists which fulfill the requirements are eligible to participate in the biddings. The assessment panel will assess the technical proposal and the price proposal in two stages, during which the manpower resources proposals and bidding prices submitted will be compared with the departmental estimates so as to assess the reasonableness of the proposals. The works departments and the information services department have reviewed the cost effectiveness of the consultancy services under their purview. 2. Appointments to the civil service are based on the principle of open and fair competition to select the most suitable candidate to fill the vacancies. As heads of department or grade are best placed to know the operational needs of their grades, under their charge, they are responsible for stipulating the entry requirements in respect of academic or professional qualification, technical skills, working experience, language proficiency, etc. Heads of department or grade should ensure that these entry requirements are relevant and commensurate with the satisfactory performance. 3. In the past 5 financial years, the total value of consultancy agreements awarded by the EACSB, AACSB, and the DCSC were 1.16 billion, 1.24 billion, 2.46 billion, 1.46 billion, 1.31 billion, respectively. Works departments would regularly review the in-house manpower resources and the requirements of each project to decide whether there is any need to employ consultancy. Employing consultancy for parts of the projects could speed up implementation and introduce innovative technologies and specialist expertise. It could avoid employing a large amount of manpower during peak seasons and expanding the establishment excessively. On the whole, the employing of consultants could facilitate the implementation of public works. In respect of promoting Hong Kong, ISD has only awarded one PR service contract to promote Hong Kong, i.e. the one with the theme Relaunch Hong Kong, in the past 5 years. The contract value was $5.7 billion. In the light of the massive disruptions to Hong Kong society and economy by rioters in 2019 and COVID pandemic, ISD decided to appoint a PR firm with expertise in crisis management, city branding, data analysis, global marketing to help devise global market and PR strategy to target key overseas market to help Hong Kong reconnect with the world and relaunch. These special tasks could not be completed by mere redeployment. The relevant agreement was procured through open bidding and is in compliance with the guidelines on appointment of consultancy firms. Mr. Paul J., well, I'm grateful to the Bureau for the detailed explanation. In relation to the ISD, the details are rather brief. Last week, we did have similar question. I'd like to focus on this question. On April 12, Oriental Daily has a report to say that $150 million spent, or $50 million per year over the past 3 years. And that's the consultancy study. So $50 million per year for 3 years, or is it upfront $150 million? Would there be any clarification? Also, this report is really controversial. Can we have sight of this particular report anytime soon, Secretary? I defer to Undersecretary for Home Affairs. Thank you, President. Thank you very much, Mr. Jay. Last year, we awarded a consultancy agreement to relaunch Hong Kong, and this is a project to rebrand Hong Kong, as Mr. Jay said in last week's question session. I've answered that it was $5.7 million or $44 million Hong Kong dollars. As we mentioned in the principal reply, the ISD over the past 5 years only awarded this contract. Any supplement? Will the report be made available to the public? President, as I said last week, rebranding Hong Kong, the work has been completed. We're happy with the effectiveness. But because of the fluctuating COVID situation, the publicity work has not quite started. By the time it is started, members of the public would know about the details. Mr. Wong Kwok Kim, President, the departments are employing consultancy firms, and this is giving rise to a lot of public concerns. And electoral members are attaching more and more importance to this. Mr. Paul Jay raised this question, but when I look at the replies, I don't know how to react. The replies are not germane to the question. The questions are whether the administration would come up with any guidelines regarding the employment of consultancies. But the verbose replies seem to be about how it is fair in procuring the consultancy firms. The second question is about the use of consultancy firms, and whether the government in the recruitment exercise that would hire people with the consultancy experience. I mean, you're stating the obvious here in your reply, and you're not really addressing any of the questions at all. It seems that the government is dancing around the question. There are some people in the industry who told us that the main reason for the government to employ consultancy firms is kind of a safety measure to deflect criticism. If the project goes badly wrong, they can deflect the criticism and shift the blame to the consultancy firm, and they can be rid of all the liability. I'm not sure who can take this question, but in any case, they just rely on the consultancy firms. Secretary, in answer to Mr. Wong's question, first of all, when we hire consultancy firms, we do have the guidelines. In my reply, I have already highlighted all these guidelines. As you can see, when consultancy firms are retained, we do have the procedures which are proper, which are really properly based. Now, if you look at the division of work, we do have the selection procedures which are formulated by the FSTB. When it comes to engineering and architecture, it would be the Development Bureau. Now, for cost effectiveness, it would be for the procuring department to assess the cost effectiveness. I understand members' concerns about these consultancy issues. It's not like the procurement of something tangible. The consultancy is about the provision of services. Why do we have to go back to the department? Anything above $10 million? So we do have three tiers of mechanism. If we are talking about general service, we have the Central Consultancy Board, and we also have the Engineering and Architectural Selection Boards responsible for their respective areas. Now, this is not tangible. I think we have to look at the expertise, the past track record of these companies, and see how we can add value to the government's work. The main reason for this design is that the procuring department and the controlling officer will look at their own needs. If they go beyond a certain amount, like if it goes beyond $10 million, we do have the selection board governing the situation. So everything is in order. Mr. Wong asked another question, and he's saying that we are outsourcing these kind of work to the consultancy work. Now, sometimes it is because of the time constraint, or it is because of absence of the expertise within the government that we go to the consultant. Consultants remain consultants. The departments are taking forward the projects. I'm sure that if there are any problems detected, like Mr. Paul Jay and Mr. Wong have put questions regarding these specific projects, I think there is a clear line of responsibility there. So we're not offloading the responsibility to the outside consultant. Nothing can be further from the truth. Mr. Edward Lau, I'd like to put a question about the engineering consultants. Now, there is some saying that the consultants are administering Hong Kong, and the consultants, I mean, the government would be taking on board whatever the consultants have to offer. In fact, the government is monitoring the consultancy firms. Now, there are projects that they got into trouble, and it would be the departments that would be taking the blame. And the consultants that are supposed to be monitoring the projects, they are getting away with it, and they don't have to be held responsible. It seems that there are only a few consultancy firms that can take on board these large projects, and there is not much of a choice on the part of the government. My question for the administration is, how are you going to address all these questions that are highlighted, Secretary? President, thanks very much, Mr. Lau, for the questions. In terms of liability and responsibility, we do have a consultant agreement to enter into. In the agreement, the scope of responsibility would be clearly stated on the part of the consultants. If they default in fulfilling the responsibilities, the government will hold them to it. There are examples in which some consultants fail to fulfill their responsibilities, and they will be pursued by the administration. And there were cases of consultancy firms having to make compensation. Now, there is mention of a monopoly. We're talking about a few consultancy firms. In the process of procuring the service, we do have the principle of fairness, transparency, and the best bidder would win the bid. We're not offering any favorable treatment. We have a lot of mega projects that are pretty complicated. Now, for these projects, the consultancies that have the past track record and that are conversant with the situation would enjoy better advantages. Now, because of the scale of the projects, we do have different expertise to be involved. And the winning bidder would partner with other companies take forward the projects. And this is a common occurrence for mega projects, and different stakeholders would be able to take part as well. Also, under the consultancy procurement system, depending on the scale and categories, they will be bidding in accordance with different categories. So the small time businesses will also be able to bid for the projects, and there will not be any monopoly by the large corporations. In 2018, we've already started this scheme, and in the bidding exercise in 2018, we would only allow the consultancy firms that are on the list, and this new method has been proceeding smoothly. There are more than 70 consultancy firms on the list. According to the latest information, the market share of the small and medium-sized consultancy firms is increasing. All these measures are having positive effect. Now, the measure has been around for 2 years or more. We will continue to monitor the implementation and keep it under review. Mr. Ali, question and answer. Well, he's stating the situation. He failed to come up with any solution. I think he just was reading out from his script. President, thank you very much for the question, Mr. Lau. I've already mentioned this. In 2018, we have established a list and also a list of different groupings, and the selection board adopted different line categories, and depending on the number and also the scale, all the different services are subdivided into two groups, and we decide on the kind of consultancies that would be allowed to take part. With this system, we can see that the small and medium-sized consultancy firms are taking up a larger share of the market, and this is contributing positively to the system. Ms. Starry Lee, the members of the public are very concerned about the consultancy fees. The government has to monitor the use of taxpayers' money. We have to save where we can. In answer to members' questions, the administration is saying that if within the government it is not appropriate to recruit people, then you would consider using consultancy firms. Now, we may be talking about specific projects. What rank of officials that would be in charge of the approval? Would it be department head or bureau secretary? And you refer to the public works and the ISD. I know that there are many other departments that are also using the consultancy firms. So each year, how are we kept informed of the amount that is spent on consultancy firm? Secretary? Ms. Lee is more like concerned about the approval of consultancy agreements of varying sizes and what departments and what rank of officials are involved. There are three tiers. Anything below 3 million, it would be the procuring department that would be giving the approval. Between 3 million and $10 billion, then the controlling officer and also the departmental selection committee would be in charge. Anything above $10 million, depending on the categories. For general consultancy firms, anything beyond engineering and architectural, then the permanent secretary of FSTB will be in charge. For engineering architectural, then it would be for the relevant selection boards. chaired by either by the ASD head or the CEDD head, and that is the Engineering and Associate Consultant Selection Board and Architectural and Associate Consultancy Selection Board. In the whole design of the mechanism, it all depends on the price tag of the agreement, and if it is higher in value, there would be a different arrangement. Ms. Lee is concerned about the level of consultancy fees, whether it's too high or too low. In the process of selection, we would have regard to this. Now we're talking about the provision of services. Not only do we have to look at the nature, we have to see how they can add value to the government work. We have 60-70% of a technical score, and the rest is for the price. It's not the case that we don't look at the price. We have to be treading carefully with regard to the price. We're not talking about tangible commodity. We're talking about the provision of services. We have to look at the track record, the expertise. We do have the combined score in this regard.
You.
Question 4, Mrs. Regina Ip. Ms. Starley, please follow up on other occasions with the Secretary because it's way past the allowed time. Please follow up on other occasions. Mrs. Regina Ip, Ms. Starley, please follow up on other occasions. Sorry, speaker's not coming through. Secretary, please give a reply in writing to Ms. Dari Lee. He will give you a written reply. Mrs. Regina Ip. Thank you, President. The Stock Exchange of Hong Kong Limited, SEHK, launched the Growth Enterprise Market GEM in 1999 and amended the GEM listing rules in 2018 to raise the GEM admission requirements and remove the streamlined application process for transfer of listings from GEM to the main board. Some members of the industry have pointed out that the amendments concerned have undermined the positioning of GEM as a stepping stone to the main board and deprived small and medium enterprises, SMEs, of the opportunity to raise funds through listing on GEM, given the fact that only one company was newly listed on GEM in the first half of this year. In addition, in the absence of investors' attention, it is difficult for the 360-odd companies currently listed on GEM to raise funds, as illustrated by the fact that the amount of funds raised by companies after listing last year was less than one-fourth of that of a decade ago. In this connection, would the government inform this council whether it knows if SEC has plans to revitalize GEM so that more SMEs can raise funds through listing on GEM? If the so, of the details, if not, the reasons for that. Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury. President, Hong Kong is a major global listing platform for companies from different jurisdictions. During the past 12 years, Hong Kong had ranked first in the world 7 times in terms of funds raised through initial public offerings, IPOs. In the first 8 months of this year, Hong Kong raised a total of $269.8 billion of funds through IPOs, representing 81% increase when compared with the figure for the same period last year. The government regulators and Hong Kong Exchanges and Clearing Limited Hong Kong X strive to develop Hong Kong into a broader and deeper fundraising platform and safeguard investors' interests. As far as the Growth Enterprise Market GEM is concerned, in response to market views that the requirements of GEM back then were abused by market participants, causing possible disruption to the order of the market of some securities and thereby affecting the overall quality of the market, Hong Kong X repositioned GEM in 2018 as a standalone board to provide a fundraising platform for small and medium-sized enterprises, SMEs, after consulting the market's views in 2017. The streamlined process for transfer to the main board was consulted under GEM, having considered the problems more commonly found among GEM issuers back then, including high shareholding concentration, illiquidity, and high share voice price volatility, which led to market concerns that the reference process might be exploited by issuers with poorer quality to gain easier access to the main board via GM. The streamlined process was also considered by market participants as being contrary to the objective of the sponsor regime implemented in October 2013, which was to ensure companies seeking a listing either on the main board or GM have comprehensive due diligence conducted on them with properly drafted listing documents prior to the admission to the reference board. If an issuer can list on the main board through transfer from GEM without having gone through due diligence process, there is a risk that GEM would be exploited given the different listing eligibility requirements between the two boards, which may eventually affect the quality and reputation of the Hong Kong market. According to the figures from Hong Kong X, the effect of the then GEM as a stepping stone was limited. For example, the total number of transfers from GEM to the main board as a percentage of the total number of GEM issuers eligible for transfer decreased from 7.2% in the second half of 2008 to 2.7% in 2016. In order to maintain a clear distinction between the positioning of the main board and GEM, Hong Kong X raised the minimum market capitalization at the time of listing of GEM applicants from $100 million to $150 million, and the minimum public float value of securities from $30 million to $45 million, while at the same time correspondingly raised the minimum market capitalization of the time of listing of main board applicants from $200 million to $500 million, and the minimum public float value of securities from $50 million to $125 million. Hong Kong X is cognizant of market views that the reference measures will have impact on SMEs that intend to list. Nevertheless, Hong Kong X has the responsibility to uphold and continuously enhance the quality of Hong Kong's capital market and act in the interest of the investing public in accordance with the requirements in the Securities and Futures Ordinance. The reference measures would help enhance the overall quality of the market and would not deprive suitable SMEs of the opportunity to list in Hong Kong. They will also facilitate the development of the main board and GEM in the long run. The increased differentiation between the listing requirements of GEM and main board will allow applicants with intent to list in Hong Kong but could not meet the main board listing requirements, including SMEs with lower market capitalization profit, to choose GEM as a more targeted alternative listing platform. In light of some feedback that the removal of the streamlined process would make the transfer to main board unduly onerous, Hong Kong X has provided facilitating measures for applicants which transfer from GEM under the new process. This includes dispensation with certain documentary requirements, exemption from the requirements on post-IPO lockup, restriction on fundraising, and appointment of a compliance advisor. Furthermore, applicants which transfer from GEM to the main board are not required to comply with the relevant listing procedures. Hong Kong X understands from the other market consultations conducted subsequently that market participants consider that Hong Kong X should further study about enhancing the positioning and functions of GEM as a specific board for listing of SMEs in order to further attract and facilitate the listing and fundraising of SMEs. On the other hand, there were market comments that the GEM listing rules should be reviewed to strengthen regulation. In this regard, Hong Kong X has launched a review to carefully consider the market's views on GEM's positioning and market perception, as well as to study about the development of similar markets in other places. If the review concludes that the changes to the GEM listing rules are necessary, Hong Kong X will further consult the market on the proposals. Thank you. Mrs. Regina Ip. President, first, the Secretary kept saying at the beginning that Hong Kong is a global listing platform with so much IBO that is irrelevant. I'm not asking about you about the performance of Hong Kong as a fundraising platform. But then you have many comments on GEM. I think they are discriminatory, and in fact, they're discrediting the board. After what you're saying, people are even more reluctant to invest in GEM. I find that most regrettable. You kept mentioning the Hong Kong X, but who is responsible for policy, you or the Hong Kong X? So now my question is, President Xi Jinping announced last week that in Beijing, there's a measure to help SMEs. They are going to set up a new secondary board for pre-profit companies to be listed and raise funds. In Hong Kong, why aren't we considering such issues? So would Hong Kong actually help large corporations to be listed so they could make more money, and then their stock prices will go up, and staff will get more stock options, and they think that's good enough. Now, you're discrediting the GEM so much, then if that's the case, would you consider setting a new secondary board to give SMEs more opportunities for fundraising? Secretary. Let me first of all respond. I'm not trying to shirk my responsibility. I'm definitely not discrediting the board. I'm just talking about facts. Now, for GEM, in the market, there are different views about it. So that's why Hong Kong X is now consulting the market, because they want to listen to views and decide what to do next. So it's definitely not a question of us checking our responsibility. We're just taking a pragmatic approach to look at the current market situation. Thank you. That's the first point. And secondly, on pre-revenue or pre-profit companies, you asked about our views on these companies. You might recall there was a market reform on listing rules. So for individual sectors, such as biotech companies, before they make a profit or even generate any revenue, they are allowed to be listed. But of course, there are certain prerequisites, because there are certainly risks involved with these companies. So they are different from companies which make profit, so we're able to gauge the performance of the management. The third point, Mrs. Regina Yip talked about the latest development on the mainland, and we are, of course, aware of that. Now, the setting of the security, the stock exchange in Beijing, they have three levels. The premium level, that's a new stock exchange. So their idea is to help SMEs. They also bear in mind the need to support innovation and so on. So for us, we are also considering how we could make sure the positioning and the functions of our GM could support the development of SMEs, because SMEs are not the same as the companies in the main board. They're at the different stages of development, and also they have different profit level. So we're not trying to kill any particular market, or we're not trying to badmouth any particular market, but rather, I hope the in financial sector and members of this council could have a better understanding. If you have a better understanding of other markets, please give us your view. So then at the next step, when we discuss the overall proposal with the Hong Kong X, we'll have a better picture. Thank you. Mr. Christopher Jiang. President Xi Jinping announced the establishment of the stock exchange in Beijing. So this is to actively promote the development of So SMEs from the emerging and innovation sector. But then in the Hong Kong X went the opposite way. It removed the streamlined application process for GEM. And so SMEs could no longer take advantage of the GEM as a stepping stone to the main board. That's why in recent years, we have seen a dive in the number of companies listed on GEM. And the GEM, stock prices don't move. And the shareholders keep changing. This is just actually the behavior of a small number of investors. And then the government has not been taking stringent gatekeeping measures to crack down on these unlawful practices. Now, the government or Hong Kong X actually has a duty to make sure the market continues to operate normally. You shouldn't just blame everything by spanning transfer from GEM to the main board, and then you think you have resolved the problem. So my question for the administration is, would you consider reviving the streamlined application process for transfer from GEM to the main board? Now, you say there have been some improvements in some of the measures, but I hope you make reference to the new Beijing Stock Exchange. So for SMEs with good quality, they are able to transfer from GEM to the main board. This is to support the national policy and also to create more room for development for SMEs. Secretary. Thank you, President. Mr. Christopher Cheung talked about the development of the market. So I think we should take a step back. We shouldn't just focus on a particular market to see what measures could be relaxed, but rather we have to look at the objective of implementing the reform. This is to make sure that our market remains to be of a high quality. And in my main reply, I have given a brief explanation of the functions of the JAM with the taken broad market views in reform. And then, so if before there was the streamlined application process, but it's no longer there. Well, it's really about, it's not about whether we have the process or not, it's about facilitating the transfer. Because we want to revitalize the JAM to a certain extent, but at the same time, there were problems identified. Now, if it's too easy to transfer from JAM to the main board, then certain requirements may not be complied with, especially in particular with due diligence. Because for main board, the thresholds are high. If it's too easy to transfer from JAM to the main board quickly, then the differentiation between the two boards would be blurred. And it's against the whole objective of regulation. And that's why there was this adjustment. That's the first point. Second point, it's not true that we're not facilitating transfer from JAM to the main board. In the main reply, I mentioned there's dispensation of certain documentary requirements or restrictions on post IPO locked up and so on. So I've explained that. So actually, there are various measures to facilitate transfer from JAM to the main board. But at the end of the day, it's all about our policy objective. What do we want to achieve? We want to make sure that we could ensure the quality of the market. And that's what we're doing. And on that basis, we'll see what more we can do as we review the functions and roles of the JAM. Thank you, Mr. Felix Chung. Thank you, President. I find what the Secretary said odd. JAM was generated by the stock exchange, and the government says, like, JAM is like your son, and now you say the son is not behaving well, and you say there are abuses, there's over-concentration of a shareholding and so on. So you gave birth to this son, perhaps in the course of the development of the child, he's been led astray by some bad elements, so you have the duty to make sure he goes back on the right track. So you could deal with the rules and the regulations. Now you're saying the JAM is not doing well, so why don't you amend the legislation or change the rules and regulations to put things right again? Why don't you do that? Now, very often with fundraising and listing people, you know, SMEs have to do it step by step, because so they start with JAM. If they develop well, then they could move to the main board. If their development is better still, then they may become blue chips. That's how they develop. So you can't say that now you've generated JAM and it's not working well, so you leave it alone. So that's why Mr. Adrina Yip is asking how you revitalize the JAM instead of letting it to its own device. Now you've gave birth to a child and you just abandoned it. Is that right, Secretary? It's not the case that we give birth to a child and then we don't raise the child properly. We're just talking about fine-tuning the JAM, and that's an ongoing effort. We're considering the next step now. That's why in the main reply, we said that we are now listening to market views, and also have our own, and then we'll consider the way forward. Now, we also need to look at the changes and reforms for JAM. There are reasons for that. You might recall when JAM was first established, it was to cater to innovation companies. So we wanted to encourage more companies from the emerging and innovative sector and small companies to be listed. So there were few requirements, and as a result, there were problems. Because people could not sell to clients which companies would be eligible, because many companies wouldn't know whether they were eligible or not. And that's why eventually there was the cash flow or market cap requirements and other requirements. And then later on, there was a set of reform measures on transfer from GEM to the main board. It was meant to revitalize the GEM market, but then the problems were found too in that process, because if the rules are too relaxed, then they will blur the distinction between the two boards. And then there may be others who are waiting to be listed on the main board, not through the GEM. They would be unfair to them. And that's why eventually there was the idea of removing some of the relaxed measures. At the same time, there were facilitation measures, as mentioned in the main block. So it's not the case that we're abandoning GEM, but rather we care very much about GEM, and we always have regard to the market views and response, and then we would make sure there are measures in place to improve the GEM. Point of order. Now, in accordance with Rule 83, I omitted to declare that I hold a small number of Hong Kong X stocks. Ms. Starry Lee, now you have imposed some stricter requirements on GEM IPO, and that it did affect fundraising by SMEs. Well, you mentioned there were abuses, but I think they involved just a small number of people. You know, as Mr. Christopher Cheung explained, there were shell companies, and then people tried to manipulate share prices, causing losses to the investors. So in that case, to tackle the problem, you should try to punish those who are breaking rules instead of just banning the transfer altogether. Also, on punishing the undesirable elements, do you have any measures? Now, we want to make sure there's a healthy development of the stock market, because while we want to facilitate fundraising by companies, we need to protect the investing public as well. Thank you, Secretary. Thank you. Yes, your concern is also ours. We want to make sure there is quality, good quality for the market. At the same time, we want to protect the investing public. So there are three ways to do so. That is pre-listing. There are certain requirements. And then after companies have listed, then if there are problems, then we'll have to do investigation. And afterwards, if someone have done something bad, then we need to tackle that. I think you're talking mostly about after people who have done something bad, Mr. Lee. So for GEM, you know that the Hong Kong X removed the streamlined application process for GEM. At the same time, regulatory actions were taken. So there are rules to minimize shell companies. So that's why there are various ways to tackle these problems before listing, after listing, and after problems arise. So, from the regulatory angle, we need to make sure that we impose suitable requirements before listing to make sure there won't be problems. So that's why what we've done is actually to respond to what Ms. Sarli has mentioned, Mr. Ronick Chan. Thank you. I would like to declare too that I hold Hong Kong X shares. Now, in the last paragraph of the main reply, it says that the Hong Kong X has started a review after taking about the market view. So is there a timetable for the review? When would you be able to announce the results? And when will you start consulting the market so the market could see a ray of hope there? Secretary, on trying to find out the views of the market, we started in May. We are now collecting views from the market. If members have any views, I would be more than happy to hear them. And then after that, we'll see what we'll do next. Thank you.
Question 5, Ms. Elizabeth Quat. President, in June 2019, the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund also known as the Fund, was established to raise funds through online crowdfunding so as to provide relief in terms of money for those injured and those arrested in the movement of opposition to the proposed legislative amendments. As at the end of July this year, the donations received cumulatively from the Fund exceeded 253 million. It has been reported that the Fund has not applied for registration under the Society's ordinance, nor does it fall within any of the associations to which the Society's ordinance does not apply as specified in the schedule to the ordinance. In this connection, with the government informed this council, one, whether it has studied if the Fund is required to apply for registration or exemption from registration under the Society's ordinance, if it has studied and the outcome is in the affirmative of the follow-up actions, two, whether it will enact legislation to regulate public fundraising activities for raising funds to subsidize persons suspected of breaking the law, and three, given that the Fund itself does not have a bank account, has been receiving donations through a bank account of another body, namely Alliance for True Democracy, whether it is investigated if the Fund has received funds from organizations or persons outside Hong Kong, and if the activities of these two associations have contravened the anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist financing ordinance and other laws. Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury. President, first, thank you, Ms. Elizabeth Quart, for raising this question, allowing us to state clearly the position of the government. As an international financial center, upholding the rule of law has always been the cornerstone of Hong Kong's success. It also lays the foundation for the orderly conduct of various trades, financial services, and investment activities in the market. The government is therefore on high alert for illicit activities. If any persons or organizations have violated laws and regulations, our regulatory bodies and law enforcement agencies will take appropriate actions in accordance with relevant legislations. If there are any acts involving attempts to endanger national security or incite, aid, abet, or provide pecuniary or other financial assistance or property for other persons to commit offenses endangering national security, bringing threat to the nation's and Hong Kong society's prosperity and stability and the living of the general public, it may constitute an offense under the Hong Kong National Security Law, which is a very serious crime. The government will take it very seriously. Regarding Scott's question, members may have already noted that the National Security Department of the Hong Kong Police Force announced last week that they had launched an investigation against the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund for suspected contravention of the Hong Kong National Security Law or other Hong Kong laws. In consultation with the Security Bureau, my reply to the question is as follows. 1. According to the records of the Society's office, the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund is not registered as a society or exempted from society registration under the Society's ordinance. Section 5 of the Society's ordinance stipulates that, unless otherwise specified, a local society shall apply to the Society's officer for registration or exemption from registration within 1 month of its establishment or deemed establishment. Section 2, bracket 2 of the Society's Ordinance provides that the Society's Ordinance does not apply to any person listed in the schedule to the Ordinance, including any company registered under the Company's Ordinance, any trade union or any trade union federation registered under the Trade Union's Ordinance, any company, association or partnership formed for the sole purpose of carrying on any lawful business and registered under any ordinance, etc. According to the records of the Company's Registry and Labour Department's Registry of Trade Unions, the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund is neither registered as a company under the Company's Ordinance nor as a trade union or trade union federation under the Trade Union's Ordinance. As mentioned above, the National Security Department of the Hong Kong Police Force is currently investigating the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund for suspected contravention of the Hong Kong National Security Law or other Hong Kong laws. If any individual or institution is suspected of any illegal act, the police will deal with it in accordance with the law having regard to the relevant statutory requirements and the actual circumstances of the case. For question 2 and 3, the government has to emphasize that any funds raised, transferred, and used must be in compliance with the regulatory requirements stipulated in the relevant laws. Law enforcement agencies will, in light of the actual circumstances, monitor and keep an eye on the operation of such funds and take enforcement actions against illegal acts in accordance with the law. Regarding members' concern about anti-money laundering, the Anti-Money Laundering and Counter-Terrorist Financing Ordinance requires financial institutions and designated non-financial businesses and professions such as legal professions, accounting professions, trust or company service providers to carry out anti-money laundering measures in accordance with the AMLO, including specific requirements such as customer due diligence and record keeping. The AML also provides that any question carrying on a trust or company service by way of business in Hong Kong is required to obtain a license to provide relevant services. If any person is suspected of providing trust or company services without a license, he or she will breach the law and the company's registry will investigate and follow up. Under the law, including the Organized and Serious Crimes Ordinance, the Theft Ordinance, etc., the activity of any persons involving the objectives of money laundering, fraud, and other illegal acts will be investigated and prosecuted. The Hong Kong National Security Law has clear provision regulating the pecuniary or other financial assistance of property for the commission by other persons of the offences stipulated in law in order to combat offences of colluding with a foreign country or with external elements to endanger national security. On the other hand, in respect of crowdfunding platform, if any online fundraising activities involve financial services related activities such as an offer to the public to purchase securities or conduct lending, the relevant crowdfunding platform may be subject to regulation by the Securities and Futures Ordinance, the Companies Winding Up and Miscellaneous Provisions Ordinance, the Money Lenders Ordinance, etc. Therefore, crowdfunding activities are regulated by the relevant legislations depending on their purposes and nature. The National Security Department of the Hong Kong Police Force is currently investigating the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund for suspected contravention of the Hong Kong National Security Law or the Hong Kong laws. The government will not comment on the operation of individual self-proclaimed funds. We strongly appeal to the public to distance themselves from fundraising activities of self-proclaimed funds which are suspected of contravening the Hong Kong National Security Law or other Hong Kong laws so as to avoid being deceived or bearing any legal risk. Thank you, President. Ms. Elizabeth Kwan. Thank you, President. Members of the public have complained about the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund. I don't understand why the government has not taken action because this fund is actually helping those who have conducted in illegal activities. Have you given them enough time to actually to transfer the funds out or actually to delete all records? I don't understand why there is no regulation on online crowdfunding. Virtual banks would all need to obtain a license. So how come they didn't have to obtain a license? And since it is in breach of the national security law, why do you not arrest these persons and freeze such assets? The government has not provided any response to my questions. Secretary, in my reply, I did mention the crowdfunding of the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund. It is now under investigation and I cannot comment on the operation of these funds. I'm sure all of you know that the fund is using the money to incite others, and this is actually actions that we cannot tolerate. In my response on something more general than the individual case, on the regulation of crowdfunding or regulations on similar conduct, we have the anti-money laundering ordinance and other ordinances regulating crowdfunding. Currently, crowdfunding can be a purpose on which can be regulated. You talked about online and offline crowdfunding. What we're doing right now is on the platform itself and not whether it is online or offline. Any action that is in violation of the law would be followed up. We're not only looking at situation in Hong Kong, we see similar problems overseas. So we need to look into how we can better regulate crowdfunding or any other funding issues. Each place differs in regulation, but in places such as Singapore, there is a special charity regulation, monitoring, funding. We will need to decide in Hong Kong whether we should follow suit or to think of other ways. Although I cannot give you specific comments, you can see that we do have the tools to resolve the problem. However, whether it is effective, then it will need to depend on how we take action. Mr. Chan Han-pan, so a non-registered fund, I'm asking for crowdfunding online in operation for over 2 years without being regulated. Is this actually a loophole that such a fund exists? If we cannot take regulatory action against such a fund, then this is really a loophole that needs to be plugged. How can a fund that does not have a bank account receive donations through a bank account of another body? How can the bank accept a bank account receiving unknown funds that are in large amounts? Is there actually a problem with our company's ordinance that gave rise to such a problem? Do you think that this is a problem with the bank? Would you take disciplinary action against the bank? Secretary. I understand that there are multifacets to the case. There is crowdfunding and also the use of the bank account. In my reply, I did mention the anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist financing ordinance requiring that any person carrying on such a way of business must obtain a license to provide relevant services. The company's registry is following up on why a license was not required from this business and whether it is operating without a license. Oh, I really cannot give you too many specifics here because it is under investigation, but we are following up with the problem. And this question has really demonstrated that there are many different sides to the problem. And based on our experience and drawing reference from overseas, we can then follow up with our own methods. Dr. Junius Ho, why do you only take action now? The fund has been in operation for 2 years. This should be under the ambit of the financial services and the treasury. I remember a question was asked 6 months ago by Alice Mack on whether this should be regulated. The secretary at that time replied that there was no need to do that. But now 6 months later, you are now investigating the 612 Humanitarian Relief Fund. I don't quite understand. Well, for someone who wants to apply to be on the GEM board, it's not easy. But then for a fund that operates here, this is on championty. I don't understand why you still allow crowdfunding to provide relief in terms of money. And it can actually be in line with the legal aid. This is actually something that has gone amiss. You haven't really regulated it carefully. Well, you don't need, I don't think you need to draw reference from overseas. You should already be an expert. So when are you going to draw up legislation? Well, give me a timetable. You have to tell us when it could be done. Secretary, I'm not trying to shirk any responsibility. I have given very clear answers before that we do have regulations, and we look at it from the view of the purpose. Ms. Quat and Dr. Ho asked about the format or means of crowdfunding. I'm sorry, I'm sure that as a LegCo member, you understand that legislation is not easy. My colleagues have been working very hard to gain your support in many matters. Our whole team works in a concerted manner to handle these situations. Other than national security, the company's registry is also looking into whether some organizations are operating without a license. But this is an individual case, and I cannot comment on the operation of this fund at this moment. And this case actually involves many aspects, such as banks. I'm sure that through our investigation and understanding, we'll be able to better draw up an arrangement. I cannot just give you an empty timetable right now. Otherwise, I will be very irresponsible. I can tell you that we are going to draw reference on what has been done overseas. We may not have experience in certain aspects, and we can try to learn from other countries. I hope you understand our point. Mr. Polze, well, which question has not been answered? The timetable, he has already addressed your question. Mr. Polze, thank you. Secretary, I'm sorry you have lots to answer today here. Very often, we feel that there has been many prosecutions by the National Security Department in recent months. You did say that we have all the tools, we have all the ordinances and regulations in place. We have the companies, registry societies, ordinance. I'm not only talking about you. How about all the other governments? Do you need the National Security Department to just try to make a turnaround? Because you haven't done anything in the past years. There are tools in place, but you haven't used any of them. The Hong Kong Alliance in Support of Patriotic Democratic Movements of China have not registered. So it's not a registered society. So what is the difficulty in finding a solution, do you just have to depend solely on the National Security Department, or should you just deploy the services of the PLA as well? Secretary, we work by the rules. So you have to first understand what tools we have in hand right now. You raised an issue that this has continued for a very long time, and why do we just take action now? The National Security Department's establishment has really been a big help, because we are now able to move back onto our regular tracks, and I'm sure that this is something the public really wants to see. For something that may not be directly related to the question today, the administration just hopes to find a solution to the bigger problem. I don't mind if you criticize me. I understand that solutions need to be found.
Last question, Mr. Chan Han-pan. President, the taxi trade has pointed out that in recent years, taxi business has been reeling from the double blow of economic downturns and the rampant illegal carriage of passengers for hire and reward using private cars. As a result, taxi drivers have suffered from income reduction. Service quality has been deteriorating. Will government inform this council, one, given that most taxi drivers place several mobile phones on the dashboard to use various ride-hailing apps, whether the government will stipulate that such apps may only send hailing messages to taxis that are stopping and waiting for customers or empty, so as to avoid drivers being distracted while driving, therefore minimizing traffic accidents? If so, of the details, if not, why not? Two, whether it will study afresh the premium taxi service scheme to enhance service quality through means such as licensed taxis forming taxi fleets, introducing new model vehicles with better facilities, and improving drivers' pay and training, so the passengers who are prepared to pay higher fare can choose taxi services which are of higher quality and safer? If so, of the details and the timetable? If not, why not? Three, whether it will expedite the legislative work on raising the penalties for illegal carriage of passengers and introduce new measures to combat such activities? If so, of the details? If not, why not? Secretary for Transport and Housing. President, thank you. President, my reply to the various parts of the question raised by Mr. Chen is as follows. One, the government has always attached great importance to road safety and has been ensuring the safety of road users through regulation by law and promoting attentive driving through education and publicity. At present, if a motorist uses a mobile phone or other smart device while driving in such way as to affect his driving, he may have committed the offence of dangerous driving or careless driving, irrespective of whether his driving has caused a traffic accident. In addition, if a motor vehicle being driven by a motorist is in motion, it is an offence for the motorist to use a mobile phone by holding it in hand or between his head and shoulder. The Road Users Code has also issued clear guidelines that motorists should avoid using mobile phones or other smart devices as far as possible while driving and should drive attentively. The government notes the public's concern about motorists, particularly taxi drivers, placing several mobile phones on a dashboard while driving. The government also understands that motorists may have practical needs to use mobile phones or other devices, for instance, for obtaining information about navigation, real-time traffic, and parking space. As to whether further restrictions should be imposed on the use or placement of mobile phones or other devices while driving, the first and foremost consideration is road safety while taking into account practical needs. The TD is conducting a study and will consider the direction of regulating the number and location of mobile phone devices placed by motorists, as well as the mode of use and the purpose of using the devices, etc. Having regard to the technological development and changes in the usage habits. To this end, the TD is making reference to the regulations and practices in other jurisdictions. Observing the situation on usage of mobile phones and other devices by motorists, and considering various factors such as whether motorists will switch between mobile applications if restriction is imposed on the number of mobile phones on the dashboard. Upon formulation of concrete proposals, the government will consult stakeholders in due course. The government has all along endorsed the general direction of centralizing the management of taxi service quality through professional fleet management. We understand that currently some taxi operators are running taxi services as fleets, providing passengers with more spacious vehicle models and compartments with free Wi-Fi and electronic payment systems, etc. They also provide various channels for passengers to make suggestions and lodge complaints so as to monitor driver's performance. In addition, some taxi operators have enhanced pre-service training for drivers and will issue warning or provide training to drivers who have been involved in improper driving behavior or bad service attitude. TD has also collaborated with the Committee on Taxi Service Quality to organize the commendation scheme to recognize outstanding taxi drivers and taxi service management teams so as to continuously improve the professional image of the industry. The government is also carefully examining different options on how to provide passengers with better taxi service quality through fleet management. In formulating the proposal, we will take into account the views of the Franchise Taxi Services Bill expressed earlier by the Bills Committee, the public and the taxi trade. The government introduced the bill into the Council in May 2019. The bill aimed to introduce franchise taxi services to meet the demand for personalized and point-to-point public transport services of higher quality with online hailing feature. However, the relevant bills committees decided to discontinue the scrutiny of the bill in June 2020, having regard to the economic situation at the time and the views of the bills committee. The government considered that then was not an opportune time to introduce franchise taxis and withdrew the bill in November 2020. The government would review the franchise taxi proposal and a way forward in the light of public views and relevant circumstances. The government has been combating the illegal carriage of passengers for hire or reward by motor vehicles through enforcement as well as education and publicity. The police closely monitor the relevant illegal acts by collecting intelligence as well as conducting investigation and follow-up actions on complaint cases. Suitable actions will be taken should there be sufficient evidence. To strengthen the deterrent effect and enhance the safety protection for passengers and road users, the TD has conducted a review on the penalties for related offences and undertaking consultation regarding proposals of raising the fine as well as lengthening the period of suspension of vehicle license and impoundment of vehicles. The legislative amendment exercise is underway, which will be submitted to the Council for consideration. In addition, the TD has put in place a number of measures to further enhance public awareness of legal hire car services and encourage the public to inquire with the service operators to make use of TD's online checking system to check vehicle permit before journey starts. Mr. Ben Chen, Madam Deputy, the Secretary admits that some taxi fleets are doing a good job and that there should be commendation. I think with better service, the drivers would expect a higher pay. Will the government consider the timetable? I'd like to follow up on what the Secretary said about the mobile phones. If you look at the taxis in Hong Kong, we can see that half a dozen mobile phones are placed on the dash and they are scrolling on the phones to take orders and distribute orders. And we are regulating merely the use of mobile phones when they're holding the phones in hands or when they're holding the phone between the head and the shoulders. Now with new technology, they're just scrolling around on the phones, and this is not being regulated. The Secretary said there will be a review. Are you going to be engaging a consultant, or are you going to have a look at the different jurisdictions before you can come up with any solutions? I think the easy solution is to discuss with the taxi trade to find the answer to the problem. Any timetable there, please? Secretary. Thanks very much, Mr. Chen, for the follow-up question. On the question of the number of mobile phones and that would be allowed on the dashboard or any smart devices, the TD has conducted some studies. Like in some jurisdictions, and it may be such regulation, the scope of the regulation and the focus and so on, the TD does have all the relevant information. In terms of road safety, the key thing is when the drivers are using the mobile phones or any mobile devices, if we restrict the number of devices, they may be switching to different mobile apps, and there will be implications. As I said in the principal reply, any changes must be predicated on road safety. And under these circumstances, we would have a look at the actual needs. In terms of road safety, anything that any motorist has done to distract the attention is not allowed, and the motorists will have to stop the vehicle before using the mobile devices. But there is some information like navigation and real-time traffic conditions. The motorists would be concerned about this while they are behind the wheels. So like Mr. Chen said, given the fact that we have to emphasize road safety, we will discuss with the relevant trade. We don't necessarily have to retain any consultants because the TD colleagues are experts themselves. By the time we have the recommendations, we will be consulting members on those. Mr. Chen, at a part unanswered, the timetable, how much longer do they need for the consultation? Any timetable, Secretary? Thank you, Madam Deputy, and my thanks to Mr. Chen for being persistent about the timetable. We are studying on the subject. When we have all the information, we will come back to members. Mr. Kwok, welcome. Madam Deputy, the government is conducting so many studies, but there is no timeline. My question, Madam Deputy, is to tackle illegal carriage of passenger for reward. We have been talking about this, but there is a lack of enforcement. During COVID, the situation is getting more rampant. These kind of illegal activities are subject to ride hailing, but these days, these vehicles are pinching passengers from the taxis, and this is compounding the problems for the taxi trade. Now, given these unfavorable circumstances, they cannot recruit any new drivers. In 2021, we have 805 applications for the license. Previously, it was 1,940. If the taxi license are not used, and the quality of service will be deteriorating, and there will be further complaints. My question for the administration is, do you have any specific measures to ensure that the taxi trade is viable and there will be sufficient attractiveness to lure more new blood into the taxi trade? Because at the moment, it's like a stagnant pool of water, and there is no new blood joining the taxi driving trade. Secretary, thanks very much for the question. Regarding the development of the taxi trade and upgrading, the government is very concerned. We have been discussing with the trade on many different options. We understand that there are operators and that operating taxi fleets, and they are hiring dedicated drivers to man the fleet for the taxi drivers, and they are out there making a living. If they can have a stable income with stable job security, then that would be a good idea. As regards the illegal carriage of passenger for reward, the government, not least the police, would take enforcement action, and they would collect intelligence, and they would pose as passengers to tackle this problem. In terms of the long-term development of the taxi trade, some operators are of the view that because of the aging population and because there are handicapped people who need taxi services, they are of the view that they should consider procuring some larger vehicles which are wheelchair-friendly for their operation. We welcome these ideas. And to tackle illegal carriage of passengers for reward is important, because that would ensure stable income for the drivers. And we will also do more in the way of upgrading the services, and that would be conducive to the healthy development of the taxi trade. Mr. Frankie Yick.
Thank you, Madam Deputy. In answer to Mr. Ben Chen, part one of the question, you emphasize that the TD is conducting a study. I'd like to say this to the Secretary. Back in 2014, I've already mentioned this, and over the years I've been pursuing the administration about this. The administration said that there is no such regulation overseas, and they're saying that we do have the right legislation governing the situation. Now, we saw the tragic accident in Taipo. It may not have anything to do with the mobile devices on the dashboard. But from the media report, we get to learn that the police would take enforcement action against drivers who have many phones on the dash. And it is a fixed penalty of $400, so with no deterrent effect. I've consulted the trade, the drivers' association, the operators. All of them support the idea of legislating against this. How much longer do you think you need for the study before you'd like to go down the legislative path?
Secretary, thanks very much, Madam Chair. Thank you for the question. There was a mention of the tragic accident in Taipo. The investigation is still going on, and I don't think we should dwell on this for the time being. As regards the penalty for road safety, we are looking at this at the moment. Earlier, for illegal carriage of passenger for reward, and also, the demerit points for taxi drivers. We did have some proposals. All these proposals are intended to make sure that there will be healthy development for the taxi trade. And for operations that
unlawful. We should not condone them. So as to the number of mobile phones on the dashboard or any mobile devices, we are looking into this. I can give the undertaking that by the time we have the initial ideas, we would come back to the council for further discussion. In the meantime, we will be discussing with the trade. I hope the members will appreciate mobile phones on the dashboard. It's not confined to taxi drivers. It's happening to commercial vehicles as well as private vehicles as well. So we would make reference to the situation in other jurisdictions and the regulation and the focus of the regulation. We will conduct analysis before coming back to members. Mr. Yik, which part unanswered? How many more years do they need? I've been talking about this for 7 years now. Right, the timeline as secretary. Madam Deputy, Mr. Yik and Mr. Chan are very concerned about the timetable. I can give the undertaking that we'll work along with the work as soon as possible and come back to the council. Mr. Tony J. Madam Deputy, thank you. Taxis is one of the modes of public transport. Over the years, the taxi services and also in terms of the comfort of the taxi vehicles, I haven't seen an improvement. If you look at the other public transport over the past 2 decades or so, there is no comparison at all. Now, in terms of the taxi drivers' attitude, this attracts a lot of complaints. I think the public are very concerned about the aging rank of the taxi drivers. Is the administration aware of the aging situation of the taxi drivers? Is it getting any worse that the administration would always say that they would deal with the problem as soon as possible, but will you be coming up with any measures to attract younger blood into the trade? You may not have the timetable now, but will you come up with a timetable for us, please? Secretary, thank you for the question. In terms of the aging taxi drivers, I don't think we should focus our attention solely on taxi drivers. Aging population is very much the phenomenon in Hong Kong. Mr. J has made the point. In fact, we have taken some measures in order to encourage young people to join the taxi trade. We have relaxed the licensing requirement. We have reduced the eligibility period from 3 years to 1 year for them to apply for taxi licenses. We're also working with the trade to entice more young people to join the taxi driving trade. We will be liaising with the Committee on Taxi Service Quality to see how we can increase their pay and also improve the professional image and also the working environment in order to attract more young people.
Questions end. Members' motion on subsidy legislation.